Okay, let's start with my person. Thanks a lot, Stefan, for the kind introduction. Here's a brief visualization, what, for instance, our students do. And here's one topic we have heard before, that's image enhancement for the automotive industry. That's just software to improve the readability of displays in bright ambient light in cars. Kestrin said, "Oh, there's one great slide in for you." That's yours, Kestrin. Yeah. Oh, no, sorry. The next one is yours. We have heard this morning and yesterday two presentations for the upcoming SID Display Week, and we have as well a presentation there next week on a smart pharmaceutical packaging with e-paper display for improved patient compliance. This might perfectly fit to the Samsung IoT kit later on. Okay, that's a slide you like. I've slightly updated it. What is my experience, my connections to Samsung in the past? Let's start here, Electronic Displays Conference, where Stefan stated I'm chairman, and a couple of or 2 years ago, we had a keynote on automotive displays from Dr. Yang from Samsung. If you see this picture, the Samsung guys might be more familiar with that. We had exactly in this room a meeting, a 1-year-long meeting, 2 years before. What I put in on last minute is, this is Schildar Sarang, and Schildar Sarang might be well known to Samsung, because he founded two startups in Germany. One was Novalet, the other one Sinora, and both were acquired and supported by Samsung later on. So both companies do in OLED material, and what might be interesting for Sinora, headquarters Sinora operations is in Bruchsal next to Pforzheim. Okay, the other one, Harman was mentioned a lot in the talks before. That's my activity on automotive displays and HMI technologies, where we pull together competences from all over the world. And that's my favorite picture with the SDC CEO, Dr. Park, after visiting my lab in Pforzheim, and we had a nice dinner together here. Okay, let's go into my presentation. I will start with a brief introduction, gave an overview and some fundamentals of I call it autonomous displays, augmented reality HUDs. We will see two videos on interior lighting and exterior signage for autonomous cars, followed by a brief summary. But let's start. What the hell is autonomous driving? Is it that? Even it's kidding, but when it comes to takeover requests on level 3, level 4, you have to deal if the right person sits on the driver's seat. And we had done some thesis together with Bosch to secure that the right person with a driver's license sits on the driver's seat. So what we will see is that cars will evolve towards the third living space. That's what we have today and what we see in future. Semi-automated cars, which looks roughly the same like today's cars, but you can take a nap or can start working in some autonomous modes. The future is living room feeling, definitely. Means for the long haul, the car evolves to a so-called third living room, like this Mercedes prototype study. And you might, during the weekend, like manual driving again on a nice road, like number one highway. Automated driving might be not a lot of fun, or Mount Diablo close by. You will drive by your own. And displays will support you definitely here, because you are no longer used to manual driving as it is today. And all these future visions have a huge impact on displays. Last but not least, I call it bring your own display, like the Australian, New Zealand, bring your own drink in a pub or a restaurant. That's a Waymo car. And this one is even suitable for kids or for the aged or for the disabled, which don't need any driver license. And these cars might not have any displays in, means you have to bring your own smartphone, for instance, to connect with the car, set the destination, etc. So here are a few other impressions about this living room feeling. So the cars will evolve to a place for work, leisure, joy, and fun. For instance, here you can do work, you can do gaming, you can have face-to-face meetings. Here's an example of a pillar-to-pillar full-size display which deals a whole dashboard here. Redressable steering wheels with a smaller display, for instance, on front of this relaxing thing, watching movies or playing games here. And you can imagine as well, if it comes to a night drive, you won't drive in an autonomous car, or won't like to drive in an autonomous car which has just a white reading light in. So, and with interior lighting, advanced interior lighting, and I will come to this later on, you can create mood in the car. And that's essential for this living room visions you see over there. So the good news as well for Samsung is, here, this is the only market slide. What's about the volume? These days, roughly 100 million cars will be produced per year. Compared to smartphones, it's incredibly low. But for cars, they're constantly evolving. And what you see here is a percentage of installation in the automotive market. The blue one is a central information display, the instrument cluster visualizing speed, wayfinding information, instrument cluster visualizing speed, and HUD stands for head-up displays. What you see is that the percentage of the installation is constantly increasing. And this is a summary of all cars, from luxury cars to entry-level cars. And this year, about 50% of all shipped cars have at least two displays in. The same story continues for head-up displays. 2 years from now, it's expected to have 20% of head-up displays in the car. Means this is a business which is constantly increasing. And there are a lot of things to do, and I will only address a few of them. So let's come to what I call autonomous displays. So as shown to you before, displays will dominate exterior and will definitely dominate UX, means user experience. In terms of size of the display, in terms of, for instance, what is shown on the display, what is the interaction of drivers, passengers, this morning we heard as well riders in autonomous cars. So you can imagine there's a huge impact on UX. I want to just briefly hit this point. And here you see, for instance, a windy road, which ends up at a winded, means curved display. Because in a car, normally, in the interior design, you have no flat surface at all. The only flat surface in a car is a display. And this is a nightmare for designers. So we have to deal on that as well. This slide shall point out what are the major challenges when integrating displays in cars. Challenge number one is read the display in terms, for instance, speed. Speed is a legal must. Just imagine you're heading towards sunset. Here's your head up. So you can imagine it, you can't read the head up. This is your instrument cluster and this is your wayfinding information. That's one challenge. So what you have to do, eye adaptation, luminance, reflection reduction, efficiency so that the devices won't get too hot. Challenge number one, number two is to display high quality images in an automotive environment. This is essential when it comes to autonomous driving because you want, for instance, enjoy a movie. And if the performance is not great, it's not a lot of fun watching, for instance, an action movie, whatever. So you need definitely a higher luminance, value, and range than nowadays. And the original scene can be compared versus display versus vision means displays have to be improved. And we have heard this morning a nice talk from Samsung, how can be introduced metrics into visual perception. And last but not least, it's eye matching, means in terms of PPI, for instance, or pixels per degree. PPI in a car is heading 300 PPI because the distance is larger than for a smartphone, for instance, and for head-up displays is 120 pixels per degree. Another big shot is the seamless integration that's design-driven. Designers won't see a display in a car. They want to show information in the car, not, oh, there's a display. And in terms of display quality, just to name a few, which makes a lot of quarrel, you see it on my hair, when integrating displays into cars. So, summarizing, we need advanced pixels in the automotive field, means higher resolution, direct displays heading towards 300 PPI, augmented reality head-ups towards 120 pixels per degree. And this figure is as well crucial for all this AR, VR stuff. If you need read some tests or evaluation, HoloLens or whatever, everybody says, oh, it looks so pixelated. What they have at the moment is in the range of 10 to 20 pixels per degree. But 120 pixels per degree means at the very end, 100 megapixel displays in front of your eye. So faster LCD at the moment has a sluggish performance and low temperature. That might be a good argument to run for OLEDs in the car, higher frame rate, less motion blur, and better pixels, larger luminance range, heading tower 10K nits, and a larger color gamut. And this both figures come from the TV industry. So how can displays evolve from, let's say, today's serious displays? They are really looking nice, but those of you who drive a Tesla might have experienced that's a great HMI, but it lacks of haptic feedback. Knobs you can touch, you can operate without looking at it. With a 17-inch touchscreen, you have to take a glance off the road and look to the display. And that's not the best thing for road safety. So what will happen in the future? Some of these pictures I've already shown. We see more displays, mirrorless cars, where the mirror is replaced by a camera plus a display. We will see sporty displays, which are cut this way here. The full bits we have seen, curved displays in the door panels, for instance. So what we need is new HMI strategies beside all this display stuff, haptic touch, gesture, voice control to make it comfortable and operatable. And what is crucial, the automotive world is relatively slow. We speak in 4 years development cycles instead of 1 year, for instance, for Samsung S8, S9, or an iPhone. And the task of R&D and engineers and production engineers is to bring these prototypes into mass production at a reasonable price. So what we will see is more, better, larger display in future. Cars will evolve to third living space, and this is all pushed by autonomous driving, because even as a driver, you will spend more time watching a display than today. And assuming that, it's sure you want to have better displays than today in your car. Okay, how many pixels will we see in a car? For a full-size dashboard, which this is a Mercedes prototype, maybe those of you who have visited the Byton booth at CES this year, it's a Chinese e-car startup. They run as well for pillar-to-pillar dashboard display. So we are in the range of 60 to 80 inches width, 8 to 16 inches height, pixel pitch at least 200 ppi, better is 300. So we'll end up with 50 megapixels, and that's 6x of today's UHD displays you have in your living room. Additional displays for leisure, work, and fun, and we add, let's say, 16 to 32 megapixel, have an augmented reality HUD in the car, so we speak finally about 100 megapixel cars. And that's a factor of 50 to 100 more what we have today in mass production. And that's a huge challenge, but as well an opportunity for all companies involved here. Okay, what is the future in terms of display technology? So I'm just a tiny professor compared to the experts in Samsung's display departments. We have a very different audience, and I will show you two examples of promising technologies for the future, which might solve, even partially, today's issue of today's display technology. All of you are familiar with OLED, organic light emitting diodes. Basically, this is a side view. We have a front plane, we have a back plane with TFTs, and we have a stack, as we heard before, RGB emitters, sets it done. Okay, who is involved in OLED knows that we have not only three stacks, we have about 10 stacks, and the issue is how to produce it on a high yield. And if you make a tiny line in the O, we end up with a quantum dot LED. I'm not talking about quantum dot backlight films as they are sold in high-end TV sets from Samsung today. That's another possibility to use quantum dots in display. Quantum dot LEDs are roughly the same like OLEDs. The difference is they can be made all inorganic. And who's a little bit familiar with chemistry knows that inorganic is normally more stable to environmental issues, etc., pipapo, than organic material. And this is essential for automotive, longer lifetime at lower cost. The color gamut of QLEDs are larger achievable than with OLEDs. That's essential for TV sets. And I don't think I'm telling a secret that Samsung is working on this quantum dot LED TV sets for future. Compared to OLED RGB smartphone displays, QLEDs have no viewing angle degradation. And in terms of R&D, the OLED performance is mostly reached today in lab scale prototypes. And production can be made with the same methods, with similar machines like OLEDs. And here you see a prototype from BOE from last year's SID. It's the essential thing I want to highlight is this display is all inkjet printed. And this inkjet printing is as well a big shot heading OLED TV sets. And you see as well that the color gamut with 104% NTSC is large. So that might be the future. Another approach, is micro-LEDs. Samsung has shown the wall at CES, that's mini-LEDs. Micro-LEDs is roughly an order of magnitude smaller. These are semiconductor LEDs, 10 micron size. They are produced on a wafer like ordinary LEDs, and with a transfer stamp process, you collect them from a dense array to a sparse array. And what you see here, this is a micro LED. This is a pixel. There's a lot of free space on the display. And this space can be used for integrating, for instance, sensors, making a display really smart with built-in sensors, for instance, fingerprint sensor, or for medical application, you just put your hand on the display and it acts like a large camera. For head-up displays, might be as well a great idea because you need no secondary optics, and so semiconductor LEDs are able to produce more than 20K nits. This is essential for augmented reality head-up displays. What is the benefit? Inorganic means long lifetime, high luminance, large color gamut, and you can do it as well, flexible, stretchable, transparent. And this is the vision of designers. What is critical? Why is it not on the market? Just assuming a yield of the basic LED production on the wafer of 90.999%, and assuming the same yield for the stamp transfer process. And this is incredible high numbers, hard to reach in any mass production. And even with that, you end up with 20 defective pixels per million pixels, means you can't sell it. So Apple already works on micro LEDs since a few years. And the latest public information I have said they will continue those, let's say, semi-mass production activities in the Silicon Valley area. So it might be a great display for an iWatch. For a future iWatch, that might be good. Okay, what else can we do in automotive? It's a Samsung prototype, and please forget about the sign here. I've officially asked to take this picture. One thing is head-up display. Another thing, use, for instance, the side windows, etc. Have a transparent display which shows you, for instance, head-up-like informations or wayfinding information like that one. The challenge is here. We are in the range of 50% transparency. From legal stuff, we need 70% transparency. What are other ideas around? This is from Saint-Gobain, one of the major glass manufacturer for automotive glass, integrating, for instance, OLED material for notification of other road users, like this directional thing here, or making steel transparent with a flexible LED in exterior camera, and this is a flexible display in the A-pillar here. And for manual driving, this will enhance safety. And this was presented, I'm a little bit involved in the evaluation phase by Wi-Fi at the IAA last year in Frankfurt. HMI and user experience, just one slide. So for highly autonomous driving, we have less driver's interaction, attention to the road, more user interaction. So what will change the use of displays in self-driving mode? It's, let's say, seconds while you drive, minutes when you set up, for instance, your music or wayfinding input. For autonomous driving, even in level 3, can be 10 seconds, minutes, or even hours. And this has a size impact by size, location, etc. And an so-called emotional GUI or HMI makes you love the car. But we see already regulations for this autonomous HMI and user experience. And to make a first remark on that, it's supposed that a good HMI, including an augmented reality head-up display, can support trust in autonomous cars because the car visualizes to the autonomous rider what the car sees. And this is really relaxing. I have an ACC cruise control, and I have no information if the car sees the car in front of a red traffic light. Will my car stop, yes or not? And so what will happen? What we have today in terms of user experience is a functional user interface. It's performance and reliability. We have to avoid driver distraction. It must be at a certain point usable. And when it comes to highly autonomous driving, those topics came up. Attractiveness, and you can only achieve satisfaction with a holistic approach. Means UX will involve from functional to emotional user interfaces. And what we might see as well in the future, depending on the car company, that the displays will show apps which are developed by software companies and not by the OEM, by the car manufacturer. It depends on the philosophy of the OEM, but I think many OEMs will head for that way. Yesterday evening, we used Android Car, and it works perfectly. So let's come to head-up displays. I will tell you a little bit about approaches, how it can be made, what are the parameters, and what are the challenges and solutions. But fundamental message is head-up displays will raise definitely safety and comfort. So let's start. We have our own race car in the university, and within a few years, last year we in top 10 worldwide. So it's a worldwide student series here, and we have built as well a small head-up, but with a large viewing angle, with through-hole LEDs, which gave us record numbers in terms of nits. And that's enough for a race car. And this was done by one of my students as bachelor thesis. Head-up displays is an old story, 100 years old. Our grandfathers had it in even 1913. So this head-up display was used for temperature control of the cooler. So nothing new. What is world record today? It's a 280 Lexus LS, and it has a field of view of 12 by 3 degrees. Some of you might not be familiar with this field of view stuff, so this corresponds to, let's say, a 27-inch monitor display seen from 3-meter distance. What I like to point out, that's the website of the manufacturer, and it looks really like augmented reality here, this arrow. But it's not implemented. What you see here is this kind of information. But that's even better than all the head-up we have today. It's, let's say, roughly 6 or 8 degrees by 1 to 3 degrees. And the price is roughly about 1,000 US dollars, means 1,000 euros, and sits in the same range like for BMW in Germany and other European OEMs. So, but towards augmented reality head-ups, how what will change. That was what I've presented you before. Today we show only, operational data, speed, wayfinding, signs, etc. That's all, like you see here. And augmented reality means we have to increase the field of view from this size, let's say, by a factor of 10. And if you have to increase a technology by a factor of 10, you need new technical solutions. So we show as well operational data in future, as well as augmented reality data, like this distance control or this green thing here means the car, the ADAS system has detected this car. So what are the challenges? We need new tiny projection displays like MEMS, laser-based or holographics. The volume has to shrink. I will show this is one of the next slide, because the volume of a head-up display is roughly proportional to the field of view. What is still under first evaluations is HMI design for augmented reality, head-up display, and its evaluation. And in terms of hard and software performance, there should be no latency between the AR content rendering, positioning, and even if you hit a bump, the image should stay stable. And it might happen that many of you have seen such a thing in the internet or in articles. This requires for wayfinding in cities require field of view of 40 degrees horizontally. So what can we do with such a head-up display? We can have the so-called annotated reality, from a smartphone or in a tablet. Extra information is provided here, might be great for a tourist, but it definitely clutters the scene and leads to occlusion. On the other hand, we have augmented reality, so virtual content is overlaid, and I think to a night drive, this is a great thing. And even in daylight drive for wayfinding, etc., this is highly attractive, and you can have some combination of annotated and augmented reality, but with this annotated reality, we must treat this topic very, very carefully. Just imagine there's a pop-up here, happy hour, beer, just $2. And behind this ad is a pedestrian, and you're going to hit it. No good idea. Okay, as announced, what's about the package size? Today, a head-up is just behind the dashboard display. And you have, when integrating a head-up in an existing car, you have to free all the space behind. And that's expensive, even more expensive. And that's one of the reasons why only a few models are equipped with a head-up display. And for instance, some French companies had for a combiner head-up because integration is easier. What I like to point out with this slide here is, this is a standard head-up mirror today, and this will increase. And we need new technologies for that. With mirrors might be not the best thing. So all companies head-up for mirrorless approaches, either holographic waveguide, like DigiLens company close to the Samsung campus here, or holographic elements. And this is driven by designers as well, because the dashboard's getting slimmer. And this means a higher dashboard. Okay, and I'm sure we won't see this in our cars. So, just a brief overview of interior lighting and exterior signage in the dawn of autonomous driving. So let's start with advanced interior lighting. advanced interior lighting can create mood and safety. So light is a design feature, not only at night, it's even on day, as contour lighting means you need high luminance. During night, we have orchestrated light, theater light. We will see information of the status of the car, for instance, autonomous state, and we will see safety by warnings. So this gives a lot of freedom to interior light designers. And here you see some example as video animation. You do a manual night drive and you approach a car in front of you. And the car ADAS function detects it and puts all your senses towards this safety critical thing here. And that's what you can do with advanced interior lighting. What does it mean? When we have 100 million pixels in a car, we will see in 2 years about 1,000 interior RGB LEDs in a car. So means car as comfort oasis. And what my part is, and that's very similar to the activities of Samsung, charging on pixels, uniformity, etc., which is as well essential for this advanced lighting here. And we've invented in the Isolate Alliance, you can Google it, a new approach, putting a smart embedded driver with connectivity on a two-wire approach into a tiny RGB LED housing. And that's the most efficient way to put thousands of LEDs into a car. So that's point one, what you can do with LEDs. Point two is for autonomous cars, it might be a good idea to tell other road users about, oh, I'm driving in autonomous mode, or if somebody is too close to you from behind, tell him, oh, please slow down. So that's from CES, we grabbed this idea in a bachelor thesis, and I've recently presented this one in China. Marcel Krause, my student, developed a model car and put, RGB LEDs in, a fully functional prototype with sensors. I will show you a video on that. So in his 6 month thesis, he did all the system here. With a Raspberry Pi, cloud computing, information manager, software connectivity for users, and some sensors. That's just for the prototype, because in a real car, you use the car's ADAS functionality. So this video gives some examples what Marcel has done. So this first, if the following car comes too close, there's a warning. Please increase the distance. You see it here. Or when it comes to road, it's SOS. Okay, you will do it wirelessly as well. So it's a pedestrian information. Just imagine your pedestrian autonomous car is approaching. Do we really know if the car will stop? So it's good to inform the pedestrian. So that's an autonomous mode. And these are some, let's say, European traffic hints to make driving more safer for other road users. So as we will see for decades, a combination of autonomous cars and old-fashioned cars, you can use these highly intelligent autonomous cars to inform, is it mine? Okay, we can inform other road users with vintage cars about, for instance, a traffic jam. And you can even do your own messages on exterior lighting. So this will definitely come as well, because it increases the safety and acceptance of other road users. So that's my summary right now. I think I'm more or less in time. So what will we see? Autonomous driving will change the use and the design of the cars. The impact on interiors, we will have more and larger displays. Head-up displays have to evolve towards augmented reality. We will see advanced interior lighting and HMI user experience, and the evaluation is one of the big shots for software engineers, etc. And last but not least, I've grabbed this from NVIDIA. The car will be becoming a supercomputer on wheels. And this means huge challenges for hardware, software, and in terms of HMI and displays, we will see emotional rather functional user experience. Thanks a lot. So, I'm open for questions.
So GM has had heads-up displays for years. We've seen them since the Corvette in the 90s, and we've been told for years that it's coming, we're gonna see more of them. Why haven't we seen heads-up displays as prolific as they've been promised, do you think?
I don't know. I have the figures from BMW. The take rate for Series 5 model, Series 7 model, is in the range of 30% to 40%. CS3 model is increasing up to 40% nowadays. And what is even more interesting, that's the so-called retake rate. You have once bought a head-up display and buy, for instance, a new BMW, 100% of the buyers who've formerly had a head-up will have it again. So and that's, let's say, one of serious hints that head-up displays will really make their way. I have no idea why is it not happen in the US. Maybe because the first experience with this GM stuff were a little bit sluggish because it was way up and not way down. Might be it was hard to read, and it might be as well that driving in the US is different. It's more cruising rather than Europe. That might be another reason.
One of your slides had a display of 20,000 candelas per meter squared or nits.
Yeah.
That's an awful lot. I mean, I've seen a 5,000 and it was really, really bright.
Yeah.
Do you really need that much, or is that a study?
I think 20,000 was for head-up. It was a micro LED. So it cuts down because of the reflectivity of the windshield. So that's just in terms of the display itself.
The output display, yeah. I see. Okay.
But for let's say, instrument cluster displays, et cetera, we will definitely speak about 2,000 to 5,000 nits.
Okay, that's still a lot, but that's not
still
20,
a lot.
Yeah.
But you know, ST2084 requires 10K.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Well, it does, but nobody uses it.
Nobody will pay.
You'd be blind if you saw the TV.
Yeah.
So.
Hi, great talk. Thank you.
Thank you.
The vision of the future is to have the entire windshield filled, you know, potentially with information that you could use. Sounds like a lot of the technologies are projecting into that windshield.
Yeah.
Right. And I guess the transparency is one of the big questions. If you could have a transparent layer that fills the windshield, that could be the screen itself. The windshield could be the screen. Are there technologies being developed in that direction?
Yes, or is that possible? There were some prototypes using windshield as a display. The very fundamental drawback is accommodation. A head-up display information is projected in 2 meters distance, reducing the time for accommodation. An aged person of 70 years needs 2 seconds to accommodate from infinity to instrument cluster. And with windshield display, it's same range. And for augmented reality, I've not really shown this to you. You have, around 10 meters that you can lay the augmented information, for instance, on the street, like this blue wayfinding arrow I showed to you. And this is not possible with a windshield display. But for instance, for side windows, might be good. And for side windows, you don't need for the rear side windows the 70% transparency stuff.
So 70% is the target. We're not quite there
yet. It's a lower end of the target.
I see. when do you think we'll be at a range that would be usable? 80? Do you have a projection?
Let's say 80% transparency of the display, because you have to integrate it in a windshield, for instance.
Okay. Is that 5 years out, 10 years out? Or do you think it's possible sooner than that?
Well, let's say 10 years.
Okay.
From now.
Cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
One more question from my side. What do you expect, how long it will take until this becomes standard in the automotive industry? I mean, typically, such features are introduced in the premium segment, and then it takes, from my experience, something like 1 or 2 decades until it covers the whole range of cars. We still have smaller cars without air conditioning and without ESP, and will this ever become standard, or will it be restricted? Because it's a significant investment, obviously.
Yeah.
So will it cover the broad range?
Is this a head-up display as well?
Okay.
Yeah. There are 3 apps. One of them is called Laser Head-Up. It's for free, and you can use it as a head-up display. Uses smartphone sensors, and it works perfect. The only drawback is, who knows it? No, works just during night because of the low luminance, and you have double reflections. But just imagine, such kind of wayfinding information at night is very helpful. We experienced this last night. And so in an entry-level car, it could be your smartphone or a Garmin-like stuff from after-sales market.
I have a couple of questions.
One,
why have windows at all when you have all these cameras that are going to be on automated cars? Why not just have displays all the way around? Or will that happen?
Pardon, I don't really get
you. You don't need windows. With all the cameras that an automated car is going to have, why even have windows? Do away with window wipers.
Yeah.
Why not just have displays all the way around?
Yeah, that's video augmented reality. same discussion you will find in the aircraft industry. One of the most expensive things is cutting those holes for the windows in the cabin. Same discussion. Something is, let's say, safety. If your displays in, let's say, nowadays car will fail, the driver can still drive and operate the car. If you have a video car where the outside view is streamed via a display, and one of these components will fail, you have to stop. I'm not sure if this fully answers your question, but it's in very interesting because for other purposes, for instance, railways or local trains, you might introduce this, but my personal feeling is, and I travel a lot by public transportation, most have their own display.
Okay. You talked partly about automated and you talked about autonomous.
Yeah.
The definition for autonomous given by several people I have heard is a car that thinks totally for itself. You might ask it to go to work, but it decides to go to the beach.
Yeah.
Okay. Where do you draw the definition between autonomous and automated?
Basically, we have these levels. Level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Level 5 is a robot car. No steering wheel at all. And from my perspective, autonomous is more US language, and automated is more used in Europe. And I've Googled it before because I had the same question when preparing my talk. And I found, for instance, on Wikipedia that it's used both ways, and there's no different definition on that. So, thank you very much. And let's say, off the record, we have prepared as well some presents for you. So, please come over here.
Thank you.
Ja. Halten Sie einfach noch. Catherine, will you try?